Okay, so today we'll continue working on the management of state in React, and also we are going to learn how to say work with the interactive elements like forms and input elements like that. Before going to how to handle forms, I'd like to make a first exercise with you. There's something missing in this table. Every table should have. I loaded
the wrong one.
It should be possible. Let me see. Sorry. Yeah, by mistake I already solved the exercise. So let me remove some code. Sorry,
I did the exercise yesterday, but probably I mixed up two different projects. Okay.
So the idea is that in a table, we still have some missing functionality, like, for example, sorting. So we are used, okay, when you have a table to click on the heading lines, click on text, and the table will be sorted by text. Click on date, and the table will be sorted by date, and so on. Okay? So how can we reason about how to implement this functionality? So implementing a sorting function is not a big issue. We have an array of elements. We just need to sort it. Okay, but the real question is where to sort it and which data structure we use. Okay, to sort. Where do we have the information about the answers? It's in a state inside app, right? So in fact, when we wanted to change a vote or delete an item or whatever we want to do, we are calling a function into app, asking it to change, to update the state variable. So our first question is, if we want to sort the table according to some criteria, for example, the score, okay? Should we implement it as a callback in app to change this state variable? So when we apply the sort, then we call a callback, and this callback will issue a set answers with a new copy of the array with a different order. That would work, okay, would actually sort the elements. Because if we change the state, set answer, with a new, so we already did it with filters, we already did it with maps, we can do it with sorts. It's a bit more complicated because for sorting an array, we need to make a copy and then sort it and then set the state, but okay, so just three instructions, okay? Just because filter and map already return a value, while sort is not returning a new array, but rather is modifying the current one. But it's just a detail, okay? The issue is that, do we really want, or is it really correct to change the order of the answers in this data structure, in this state information, just for the purpose of resorting the rows in the table? Maybe it's not the right place to do. So if we are just changing the display, it doesn't need that we need to change the data, the model, the data model of our application, the real state of our application. I will try to clarify with two examples. One, if we want to add a sort of a hide functionality here to a row, maybe we want to show or hide some of them. Okay, I don't want to see this answer. It's quite obvious that hiding a row doesn't really delete that row. So the fact that a row is hidden or not should be some information that is local to the table and doesn't change the global set of answers, the global state. Okay, same issue if we want to reuse this information somewhere else. Okay, imagine that right now we are using answers only as a property of this component here. But if we had a more complex application, and then we have some other component elsewhere in the page where maybe, I don't know, we show the latest answer, for example, a small box where we always have the latest answer displayed. So it would be a surprise. So the latest answer would be the last element in our answer state, or the one with the highest ID or so. If we shuffle this array for sorting the table, for the purpose of sorting the table, that would change also the last answer, because the last one would not be the last in order of insertion, but that would be maybe the last in order of date or in order of score, however we sorted that. Okay? So the idea is that this simple functionality, sorting, is a display issue. It's not a model issue. For sorting information, like for hiding some elements and so on, is something that happens when we are trying to display an element. We are customizing the display of an element. If we decide to hide a column, we are not going to delete that column from the data, right? So the idea is that it's better to manage the sorting of the table inside the component that is currently generating the table. Right? So we have this answer detail component that could have some local information about the sorted order of the elements. Okay? So if we want to sort the order of the table, we don't change the global state. It's not a real change of information. It's a change of display strategy. And the display strategy can be made local. So we don't need to push everything up there, okay, in the upside. Okay, so the idea could be inside the answer details. So let's go to question with answers, answer details. We are rendering a table, and the order of the element in this table is defined here. props.answers.map. Okay? Whatever the order of props.answers is, the map will create a table with that order. So our trick would be just simply, instead of displaying the elements in props.answer, we display the element from another array that is sorted. It's kept sorted according to our criteria inside this component. The other components don't need to know. Only this component needs to have the list, decide how to sort it, and use the sorted version here. So it could be not props.answers directly, but we could have sorted answers array here, right? So, of course, we need to compute it in some way. But the idea is that we receive some property, we do some computation of these properties, and we use the result of the computation for rendering the table. So what is sorted answers? One first idea could be, okay, since the answers is a state variable that is passed down to properties, that property, prop.answers, cannot be changed. Okay, a property that we receive should be treated as an immutable object. So we cannot sort, we can, the list of things we cannot do is something like props dot answers dot sort. This is forbidden. We cannot try, we should not, we must not try to modify a property that we receive. It doesn't, it's unpredictable, we don't know the result, okay? Because it's not, this is the reference to a state and we cannot modify state directly without passing through a set state call. So this is out of question. What we could do is to maybe, I have two options here to propose to you. One is saying sorted answers could be a copy of prop.answers. So let's make a new array and then we can sort this array. A, B. A, B. I don't know, let's sort by score, for example. A.score minus B.score. For example, right? So this is a possibility. We get the props, we copy them into a new array, and we sort this new array. And then the rendering will start from the contents of this new array. This is one possibility. Another possibility could be of defining a state sorted answers, set sorted answers, use state, and initialize this state from the list of answers. So the idea is that I create a local copy in this component of the global state, and then I can sort this local state according to my criteria. Of course, sorting this would mean having some callback for doing a set sorted answers that will take an old version of the state and then execute some code for copying in a temporary array the old state and then sort in this temporary array and finally return it. Something like that. Okay, it's not complete, it's just some pseudocode. So the idea is that we define a state variable and the state variable is able to track in some way the global state of the application, which is received through properties, and then is also able to change this order locally. What are the good and bad pros and cons of these two possible solutions? Well, of course, we are not going to do a sort here or a sort set sorted here unconditionally, okay? Of course, this sort operation would be inside some callback function. When we click on the column name, then we sort, okay? But apart from that, of course, we need to decide when to do the sorting. These are two different options, okay? One is called derived state. We are deriving a local state from a former state that we received through properties. And the other is just a recomputation, local computation. We can see the local computation seems we are inside a function, okay? It seems expensive because every time we call this function, that array is resorted and resorted again and over again, many times. Every time we call the function, we are creating a new array and we are sorting it. Why, in the second case, it seems that we are remembering the previous sort order and we recompute the sort operation only when there's actually some need for doing that. The user actually clicked on that. So there's a, when you start, you know, managing state in components, there's some sort of a tendency, sort of a desire to not to recompute things. Okay, say, okay, I already have this value, I store it in a state variable, and then I will update it when I want, okay? Which is possible, but normally, generally speaking, it's a bad idea. It's a bad idea for several reasons. One, for the first one, the most important one is tracking the global state. In the answer details, okay, here I'm making a copy of the state, the real state of the application is in app, right? I'm here initializing a copy of the state, starting from the information I got from app. Good. But what happens if the state changes in app? Because I deleted something, because I voted something, because I added something? That would be a problem, because this initialization here, this value, this initial value is only considered once, when this component is first created, when this function is called for the first time. So if we do this and we change the state, well, the table will not change. Let's see it. Let me comment the first part and keep this one. Let's say we are sorting by score or any other. So this should probably let me see. I need to create an event handler, because right now I created an infinite loop. Because I'm changing the state unconditionally inside the component. So every time I change the state, the component is re-rendered, so the function is called again, and when I call the function, I will change the state again. Even if the sort result will be identical, it will be a new object. So from the React point of view, it needs to re-render. So we put this into a callback-like function, sort by score, for example. Okay. And this function may be associated maybe with the click on the score column. On click, sort by score. Something prop is not defined where. Props. I'm missing an S somewhere. Okay, props. Okay. Right now nothing happens because they are already in sorted order. So let's imagine we reverse the sorting order here. So I reload the application, I click on score, and actually it's being resorted. Okay? So what I'm seeing here is a table that contains the local state. And with my callbacks, I can manage the state and resort and shuffle it as I like. But what happens if I try to delete something? It won't show. So I'm clicking, believe me, but the row doesn't disappear. What is happening is if we look at the app level, the answer state is really empty, actually empty. So the delete did happen. I really deleted that item. So let's follow the code. I'm in app. I deleted with the delete answer that called the set answer, so it changed, it asked for changing the state in app. And so this state answer was correctly changed. Good. This state answer is passed down as a property to question with answers. And we look at question with answers, the question with answers component. It actually receives a prompt with an empty answer array. It's correct. And then question with answers is passing this property down to answer details. And answer details is receiving a property called answers, which is empty. So everything was deleted. But it doesn't show. Because, why? Because we are actually showing the table according not to the properties, but to the local state. And the local state still contains two elements. When the props change, the function is called again with the new value of the props. But the state is not reinitialized a second time. Okay? So we are, in a way, with this code here, taking a snapshot of the value of this answer list at the moment in which the component is created. And we cannot expect the local state, the derived state, to be able to track the global state. It doesn't automatically track the global state. I took a snapshot time ago, and then this copy is independent from the previous one. It doesn't follow props. If props change, the component is rendered again, but this state is not changed. So what we should do in this case is to do the work twice. When we delete at the top level, we also delete at the lower level. Or you could start going to strange attempts at re-updating the state according to the change of the properties. Okay, so an idea that a sequential programmer has in mind, okay, oh, right, the props changed, so I need to reinitialize or to reset my local copy of the state. The issue is that you never know when the props change, because you don't have access to the older version. So when the function, we are in a functional setting after all. So when a function is called, it doesn't have any memory, it cannot have any memory of the old version of its parameters. So how can a function know whether the props it's receiving right now did change from the previous call? It cannot know. Also, I need to create another state to remember the old props. No, don't go that way, okay? Don't make it more complex. So, the best solution is the other one. It's the one in which we take the properties and recompute the information that we need to render the component every time. So every time the props change, the component is called again and we recompute what we need according to the current sort order. Okay, so in that case, so it generally a bad idea, and because the first the real reason, the first reason is because one, difficult to track, impossible. It's not really impossible, let's call it in this way, to track changes. And second, we are duplicating information. The same information is now in two different states, in two different components, and we all know that having the same information in two places is just looking for trouble, okay? Because then you need to do extra work to keep them in sync with the strong limitation of the information flow that we have in React. So it's normally a bad idea. If you're trying to create a state which in some way copies some old state, think twice, okay? So derived state is generally a bad idea. It's better to do local recomputation. So we take the current properties and we sort them. So in this case, what happened here? I changed something. Sort by score, okay, sort by score function is not defined. So in this case, sort. So let's remove this for the moment. Okay, so that right now I'm getting the props, making a copy and sorting that and showing that. Right now our code is unconditionally sorting, so it always sorts in that specific order. We need to add some interactivity, okay, to choose ourselves. Okay, but right now we don't have any problem. If we are deleting something, it just goes away because the component is re-rendered with the new properties. The component doesn't even know whether it's the first render or the second or the third. It just computes from an array, it sorts and displays. We don't have any local state in this component anymore. We commented all of that. But right now it's always doing the same sort. We want to customize it. We want to sort it only when we click, for example. So we could do the same as before. We could embed this sorting operation inside some sort by score. And this sort by score would be again a non-click event into the column name. Okay? So on click, sort by score. So if we click on this column, we are calling this sort by score that will actually sort these answers. And it doesn't work. Because if I click on score, it doesn't change. Well, the function is called. If you are not sure, let's put a print here. So let's try again. If I click here, the console is telling me that actually the callback has been called. And if the callback has been called, the array should be shuffled in sort order. Why don't I see it? Because the component is already rendered. Let's think of the order in which the operations are done. The function is executed. So I'm making this copy, and from this copy, I'm returning a set of lines, a set of rows in the table. Good. The component is rendered. Then the user clicks on this button, and clicking on this button will change, will execute this function that will change a local variable inside the function. This is a local variable. It's not a prop, it's not a state, and so it does not trigger a re-render. changes something, but this change will not trigger a re-render. And so we don't see the new version. And so what you can think is, okay, let's find a way to trigger a re-render. Let's change a state variable randomly. It doesn't work. Because if we make a new render, it will start with a new variable. After all, it's a local variable in a pure function. So every time the function is called, it will start again with a new, a fresh variable. Okay, so the callback is called after rendering. And at the new render, the variable is reset to its initial value. There's no way that an action from a callback could influence a local variable. Well, it can influence a local variable, but we don't see any effect because the render already happened. And if it's a local variable, at every render, it will be recomputed from scratch, pure functional way. So, in a way, the component must remember whether the data should be sorted or not. So we need the local state. Because this table, let's think about, again, the functional model. This component may render an unordered table or a sorted table. And you should be able to change this configuration. So it's some local information that will affect the way the component is rendered itself. Does not come from outside. It's not a property from which the component may decide whether it should I sort or not. It's some local information where the component decides how to behave. So it's some state information. But this state information is only about whether to sort or how to sort the table. And this local information does not contain a copy of the data. It contains instructions how to sort it. And then when we need to sort it, we start from the props. So whenever the props change, we will resort a new table, the new values, because we are recomputing from scratch. Whenever the sorting information, local information about sorting changes, it will again recompute with this new local state. Okay, so we need a very simple local variable. Let's call it, for example, sorted. Set sorted. Which is just simply a Boolean value. Use state false. So let's start initially without sorting. So now the component knows how to render itself. It will render a copy of the props if sorted is false. And otherwise, if sorted is true, then it should sort this local variable. So this is code that will be executed always at every render. I make a copy of the properties, the latest version, so whenever the props change, I'm ready to a local variable, and maybe I change the order in this local variable, maybe, depending on a local state. Again, this is a state sorted, is a state variable, so whenever the state variable changes, the component is re-rendered with a new value of state. So we are sure not to miss any change. And so what does the callback do? The callback just flips the sorted state. Set sorted to true. You see what I'm doing? I'm a local state that will tell the table, or to tell the component, how to render itself. and we have some stupid logic from which the component is managing this local display state, let's say. Whenever you update the display state, the component is re-rendered, but the key point is that when it re-renders, it will start from scratch, from the current value of the sorted state and the current value of the properties. So this should work. I reload the page, I click on score here, and what happens is that this component here is now answer details does one state variable, which is now true, previously it was false. And this affects the recomputation of the state. But if we change some property up above, so let's delete an L, or we change the vote, or we delete something, it will be propagated normally. And it will keep, of course, it will remember the sorted state, so it's the local state of the component. Okay? So the local state is telling us how this information affects the rendering, but it doesn't. We never have a copy of the same information in two different state variables. And according to the current state, of course, the rendering can be changed. The idea is that local variables can be used, can be computed, you can do anything you want, but just remember they start, we are defined somewhere, and they die in the return. So you cannot use them. No, local variables are reset every time you call the function, and are forgotten every time you return the result. They are not really forgotten because some closure might remember them, but the new value cannot be used. So there's something really temporary. Local variables in a component are something that helps you do some computation, and then you throw them away. If you need to remember something, it should be a state. And this state should be as independent as possible from other state variables that you are in your application. Having states that depend on one another, this was an extreme example where we were making a full copy of the state. But even if you state that maybe the number of rows in the table, for example, the number of answers, never put that into a state variable. Because then you have the trouble of updating the state every time the list of answers changes. Recompute it if you need it. If it can be computed from existing state, it must be recomputed. Don't be afraid of spending CPU time. Okay? For the moment. If we will have performance problems in the future, there is another hook which is called use memo. This is used to store the partial computation when these partial computations are expensive. But it will not create another state. So that would be another way of saying, okay, this computation is becoming too expensive. I'm recomputing many times, and so I want to cache the result. That is the purpose of the use memo hook, not use state. Use state should really add some information to your model, and this information should be not duplicated, and as much as possible should not be dependent or cross-dependent on other state variables throughout all the application. Okay, it's some sort of a rigid rules. Sometimes we want to escape and we want to find a shorter way, but actually the shorter ways that I know are always worse. So you would get into much more trouble than trying to become friend with this way of implementing. Okay, right now we have a very stupid sort, because you can only sort in one sense, but you cannot reverse the sorting or whatever. So if you want to do something more complex, maybe this is not just a Boolean state, it should be maybe a variable with three states, right? Sorted up, down, or not. for example. So if you want to do something more useful and also show to the user whether something is sorted or not. And so we can, but right now the big idea, the concept is already there. The idea is that the component has different display states. So this is a display state which is managed by the component. Display state will affect the rendering, and we have some rules for evolving. Right now we have a very stupid rule. When I click there, it becomes true. That's it. Let's make it more useful, maybe. I can click it and cycle through three different states. So for example, we may have we have three values, we could use three strings, for example, or three numbers. It's not just a Boolean, true or false. So we can use sorted none. It's not sorted, for example. And then the function sort by score would change the value of the component if, for example, sorted is none, then set sorted up, as if sorted up, then set sorted down, as if sorted down, set sorted none, for example. So every time we click on the button, this sorted variable cycles through three different values, and according to these values, we sort is sorted is up, then sort in an increasing way, as if sorted down, then do the same in a decreasing way. Just remember that this set sorted is not changing the sorted, but is scheduling a change for later. So that's why we don't want to sort the elements here, it will be useless. We set a state that will affect how the variable is sorted in the future, in the next rendering, which will happen soon because we are changing a state, so the component will be re-rendered soon. Let's see. Reload everything so we can see something. We have now in answer details a state which is none. If I click, the state becomes down, becomes up, and will change the order. Of course, in the right now we only have two elements, so the none is equal to down, for example. Okay, so if we maybe if we add another one, minus 10, 0, another one with something in between. Something in between so that by default they are not sorted. Okay, so in the none state, they are just in the order of insertion. If I click, they become up from the smallest to the larger. And if I click again, they become down, so from the largest to the smallest. And if everything is right, if I change an element, it will then move. So So the order, every time I click on a state, it will recompute according to the current score. If it's down, then it will, and one number becomes larger than the other, for example, okay, this Mario Rossi, when it becomes 3, it jumps to the first position. Okay, and again, if I want, I can increase this one and let it float up. It's recomputing everything every time, according to the current state and the current sort order. There's only one detail missing, is that in this right now in the interface, if we don't look at the state variable, we don't know the current state of whether the table is sorted or not. So we should have some visual, maybe a small arrow here that will tell me, okay, I'm being sorted or not. Okay, and so we can just create that maybe with a variable with just a sort icon, let's say, and we have three sort types. So switch, let's make a switch statement. Or we can also do that here. So let sort icon equal to none, for example. And if it's up, we change the sort icon to an up arrow. Otherwise, we set, this is just a local variable. Okay, so we use it normally, we don't have the state. We are not modifying the state. Equal to down, so V. And this sort icon, we just render it here. So we have a visual indication of whether the table is sorted or not. Very ugly, but at least that's the idea, okay? And everything, of course, if you vote or you delete an element will still work. We have two independent states that do different jobs. One is the application state, and the other is the display state of a component that is managed by the component itself. Okay? Of course, if we want to make the table so that it can be sorted on different columns, we should make this state variable more complex. So maybe it should be, I don't know, one object that contains the name of the column or the number of the column and the order, up or down. Or two different state variables, one with the name of the column and the other with the order, right? It's up to us, of course. Right now, this table can be rendered in three different ways: unsorted, up, or down. If we want to let any possible column to be a sort, to be susceptible to sorting, so 1, 2, 3, 4, we must have state information to be able to distinguish between the unsorted state and 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2, up and down on the first column, up and down on the second column, up and down on the third, up and down on the fourth. So we need 9 different states. This component can render in 9 different ways if we want to make it sortable by every column. Okay, that's some code to write. Let's try to do that in a compact way, but conceptually it's the same as here. Of course, that would mean that the state would not just be a string So we moved up from a Boolean to a string when we move from 2 to 3 states. If we are moving to more, of course, I don't want to have 9 different strings. Maybe I need to split the name of the column or the number of the column and the order, the direction of the sorting. I can make one state with an object with 2 elements or 2 different states. It's the same. They are always managed together in any case. Okay? And of course, this if sorted will become more complicated because I really have to sort according to different fields. So it's not just score, it could be text, it could be data. And if you have strings, you don't just have a minus sign, it's more you will have some work to do. But the idea is always the same. I have a state that will tell me in which of these 9 states I want to render the table, and then it will do some computation for figuring out the right order. Okay? We are not doing that right now. Any questions? Okay. Just remember this. This is an easy example. When we are deep down into something more complex, the drive of creating a new state is very strong. Try to resist. Try always to ask yourself before creating a new state, can I compute this information from what I already have? Props or state? Or can I create some state that only holds some minimal information from which I can compute what I need? Try to be minimal with state because having complex and interconnected state makes it very difficult to keep it, consistent. Okay, so that was, we didn't learn any new stuff. We just explored the consequence of what we know about states, rendering, and properties. Okay? But it becomes interesting to find a good solution. Then one step that we have to do today also is to be able to manage, so where's the browser? Be able to manage forms. Okay? Right now we just have displayed this, but it doesn't do anything. Well, we know how to actually add something to the list. We already had some callback written a couple of times ago. We have a sort of a add answer callback. That would be easy. The problem is how to manage these items. Because right up to now, if you consider, we rendered a lot of components, but all these components are passive. They don't do anything by themselves. The only thing they can do is can react to some on click, maybe, when we click on them. And then they will trigger a callback function for us. But input elements do have some life of themselves. They can evolve, they can be changed by the user, you can copy and paste, you can edit, you can do. And so in a way, they have a life that is independent from our props and our state. If I type here ABC, it doesn't go into any state, it doesn't go into any props. So it's out of control from the React world. Okay, so let's see how to make them controllable by React. We see some slides now, and then we'll try to implement them after the break. So the slides are here about forms. Okay, when the designers of React thought forms are, of course, an essential part of any interactive application, whether they are input elements, they are checkboxes, radio buttons, or whatever, right? Unfortunately, in HTML, all the DOM elements concerning the forms are designed in a different way. So if you have an input or if you have a checkbox or a radio button, they will have different properties and different information you can get out of them. So what the designers of React did was to make a uniform version of these elements. So we won't, we will not find the same exact properties that we have in the DOM. Now, in a DOM, a checkbox doesn't have a value property, for example. Or a text area doesn't have the value of the text inside because you need to check the text content of the children. Okay, let's not make it a long story. Basically, React makes it simpler and more uniform to deal with different types of input elements. Basically, every form element in React contains one value attribute. The value is the value currently displayed in the element. And it's a property of the component, of the input component, so that React can decide what goes into that input element. And this is uniform. So you can apply, you have a value attribute on a text area, on a selector, or an input, all the HTML input forms. Okay, it's simpler. Actually, there's another attribute which is called default value, because normally you have an input value, you have a form that by default, where's the browser? By default is empty, so the default value is empty, and also the current value is empty right now, but if I change the current value, it will become different from the default value that the form had initially. That's the whole point of forms, that we can change the default value to something that the user wants, right? So we have these two properties. When we create, a new component, we can control the default value and the current value. And there is an important event that is fired by all the input elements, all the form elements, which is called onChange. And onChange is an event that is called whenever the user changes something. So we'll add or delete or modify even one letter inside an input field. So every time you type something, it will fire an onChange event, which is different from HTML. In HTML, the change event is only fired after you go out of the form of the input element. If you want to do something on every keystroke, you need to handle the onKeyUp event, for example, or onKeyPress, which is a bit uncomfortable because if you're doing some drag and drop with the mouse, the keypress will not be called. But all this is in normal DOM that creates a lot of problems. In React, it's very simple. Everything something changes, it will call the onChange callback. And on all the different types. So these three attributes let you play with all the type of inputs. Input checkboxes, radio buttons, selects, and so on. Value, default value, and on change. They all behave in the same way. And when we have the on change callback, every callback, of course, is an event parameter. We already learned that. And even dot target is points to the source of the event. No? This is the same that we learned in the DOM world. Here they are replicated that in the same names. Okay. So if we have an event handler, you need to know what changed or which element was changed. We just go to event.target and .value, and we'll give you the current value of the change element. Okay, there are other events, a long list of events that are being reconstructed, rebuilt in React, starting from the DOM ones, because some DOM events have special cases, so in React they try to redefine them. But for the moment, we just need to focus on the change, basically. So this on change here with the on click we are using, and there are a lot of other events that you can manage. Okay, we already know that event handlers should be functions and should not be, we must remember not to call the function in the definition of the handler. This is something that we already learned, so I don't need to repeat it here. And in many cases, if you need some pass some parameters in the event handler, you need to define your own error function in line. Okay, that's something that we already know. But the real point is here about the state. Who owns the state? Basically, an input element, let's make the input as an example because it's easy, has a state, owns a state. The state of an input element is its current value, right? Because if you see at this page, this input element is showing something different. So you must remember what it is showing. So in the React speaking, it has an internal state. The problem is that this state is internal to the DOM element and is not visible to React. It's not a React state. It's an internal DOM state, the value attribute of the DOM node. We must learn how to control this value with React. Normally, we don't want a component to have a state on its own. We want a component to have a state that is dictated by the rules of React. It's dictated by some properties, okay? But at the same time, this state should be changeable by the user, should be modifiable by the user. So there are two different ways of managing states with the form component. The one which is preferred, because it's cleaner and it's also easier to use, is to have controlled input components, controlled form components, let's say form in general, not just the input element. This means that the state, the current value of every form element is controlled by a state variable from React. And we see in a moment what it means. In the other case, we may have, it's not forbidden, to have uncontrolled components where the component keeps its own state independently from the React state. And so the problem would be how to read this information, and we can only read this information when the form is submitted, when we have some external event where we go and collect this information. But in the meantime, the browser is doing its work and React doesn't do anything. That's why they call them uncontrolled. They do whatever they want, and sometimes I need to read the information. It's more like the DOM programming, when you go into submit and you collect the values from the different elements in the form. But for example, if you want to have some extra validation, some extra control, so you don't want a user to insert some kind of special characters in your fields, you need to be able to control the state while it's evolving, not just at the end. So you want to have more control, you want the component to behave in a controlled way. Control component means that React, some way, is rendering some form elements. Okay, in the render function, I have an input, I have basically an input or a selector or a text area. And when I render this component, I'm forcing the state, its state. Forcing the state means setting the value attribute. If I'm setting the value attribute on an input, I'm forcing that input to display this value. And this value will come from a state in the React component that is rendering this input. So I have a component that renders an input. And when it renders an input, it forces a value. This value comes from the state of the component. So if the state is X, the input element will always show this value of X. And this would make the component not just controlled, but read-only, in the sense that the user cannot modify it, because the value is always enforced by React, by X. The value is always X. Whenever X changes, okay, the value is changed, but whenever X doesn't change, the display, the input will always display the same value. So if you try to type into it, you won't be able to. You're controlling it. That's why whenever you set a value, you must always provide an onChange handler. So that when the user types in something, you are actually honoring its request for changing. Means that when the user is typing, then you have a callback that will update the state according to what the user just typed. Let's make a simple example. Let's add one outside of everything. Let's make one component inside this project. It's no problem. We will delete it. Test input .jsx. Okay. Function test input props, and we just render just an input element and let's render it from main, just a very quick hack. Test input. And I need to export and to import it there. Okay, this should render. Where's the browser? Yeah, an input element down there, okay. Right now, it's an uncontrolled input. React doesn't know what I'm writing here. If I want to make it controlled, I can set, so in the test input, I can have a value. So let's say name, insert your name, okay? A state name, set name, use state, empty string. And so the input element should have a value which is enforced by the current name. So I'm controlling the input by setting its value to a local state. What's wrong here? Use state is not defined, right? I need to import it. Okay. So right now I have an empty box in which I cannot type my name because the value is from the variable name and the variable name is the empty string. There's no way of changing the variable name unless we call set state, set name. Of course, if I had initialized this in a different way, it would show up differently, but always impossible to modify. Okay, so let's give the user the possibility of modifying that by on change, by defining the on change handler and define a callback. Let's make it separate for the original function. Update name received an event object. Normally we would write it in line with an arrow function, but it's the first time, so let's write every step. And what this function does is to extract the modified value, because actually the input value, the user types something and modify the internal value of the element, which is then overwritten by React by setting the old value. And we update the state according to the value that is coming from the user modification. The value from the user modification is event.target. What am I writing here? Event.target that gives me the reference to the node, to the input node, dot value, which is the modified, the attempted modification by the user. And we accept this modification by updating our internal state, set name, with this. So whenever the user tries to change something, we extract the changed value and we update our own internal state to that value. So the input will always be blocked on this state variable, but the state itself will be updated according to the user types, what the user types. And so it looks like before. I can edit, I can cut and paste, I can do whatever here. The only difference is that before, when the input was uncontrolled, it was the browser that directly modified the value. Right now, it's my React application that every time I type something, it will call the callback, update the state, and re-render the input. That's the normal way in React to change something. And this is good because this component that may be handled many inputs already has all the information in its state about the content of the form. So it can act immediately on this state. It's inside the state. Okay? So when we need to submit the form, for example, with the onSubmit event, we already have, we don't need to go and seek and check what is written in the different input elements, because we already have all the information in the state. And also, if we want to sanitize the input, for example, I want to only let the user insert letters and not numbers, for example, I can do that here. Before doing the set name, I can check the new value, I can decide whether I will accept the new value or not, or whether I want to, you know, convert it, delete some characters, whatever I want to do. I set the name to any expression I want. The simplest case is that let the user write whatever they want and just copy the value, the event.targeted value inside the state. If you want to do some more control, we can do that. Just remember that it will make maybe sometimes editing stranger to the user, because when they type something, it will appear, and some other time it will not, so it will not be very easy to. But if you want, for example, to force a field to only contain numbers, you can do that here. If the user types a letter, you want to call the set state. And if the value only contains numbers, then you call the set state. Easy enough to control. Okay, so remember that by setting value, you control the component and you make it read-only, impossible to modify. By also setting on change, you make it possible to modify, controlled and possible to modify. Okay, so these two should always go together. And we need to create a lot of small event handlers like this to update. For every input element, we have a state variable, and we have a callback for updating that state variable. So it's a bit maybe long to write if we have many input elements, but the pattern is always the same. Create an input element, create a state variable, force the state variable, and define the callback. This is just an example that we just wrote. And we don't, okay, in the case you want to create an uncontrolled for component, basically the idea is that the state is inside the element and there is no state variable. That means you don't specify a value. If you don't specify a value, you let the component evolve its own state, internal state. But you need then to, so the on change is internally handled by the DOM node. Of course, when you submit the form, you need in some way to collect that value because the React has no information whatsoever of the current content of the element. Okay? We'll try to always use control components so they always fill our pattern, but uncontrolled are also possible, more complex to handle. Speaking about forms, I can't refrain for saying that all the data entered by the users should be some way validated. Okay, so before saving some data, we need to check whether the data is valid, whether the date is correct, whether the string length is different by zero, or a lot of other checks. Okay, so it will be a pain, and we'll be doing some of that. The hint is that since this is a so common operation, you know, trying to validate a set of data coming from the user, there are several libraries for helping us do that. So if you want, we have a link here to one of these libraries, or there are some, let's say, bigger libraries. One is Formic and the other is UseForm, which are famous libraries in React that will help you creating your forms, complex forms with validation rules and so on. If you need to do something actually complex with forms, you may think of having a look at these libraries. Okay, the idea is always the same. We have these control components and the event, but these libraries make it easy to apply validation, display the error message, block the submission if the form is not validated, and a lot of other, let's say, low clerical stuff that needs to be done. Okay, and the library will do it for you. Okay, so that's all I needed to say about handling the forms. So I would suggest that after a break, we can implement this functionality, these two functionalities actually, adding a new answer and editing a current answer. And we'll see that adding is easy and editing is not so easy. For exploiting also the, say, power of React, the idea is that we try to manipulate or manage or rewrite or refactor this component new answer form. Okay, that right now generates a table. Let's make it a separate component, so that we can display this component in add mode or in edit mode. It will behave differently. So most of the functionality will be the same, but the action for adding or the condition for adding are different from the condition from editing. So let's let's turn this component that right now is only rendering some uncontrolled inputs. They are called form control instead of input because we are using the bootstrap library, but they are input elements. It's the same. The logic is the same. They are uncontrolled because I don't set any value here, but I will. The idea is try to think of this component as a versatile component that can be shown for inserting, for asking a new answer to be inserted, or for editing a current answer. So we'll need to think about, and so during the break you can start thinking about the states of the application. So no longer the state of a table where we're sorting, but the state of the application as a whole. The application could be in a state where we just display the table, or in a state where we are inserting a new element, or in a state when we are editing a current element. And so we must have some place where to store the information, because the form must know when I submit it whether it should modify some existing line or add a new line. So this information about the behavior of an element should be stored somewhere. The application should be aware of what it's doing. So we'll think about sort of a state machine for the different states in which the application can be. It will be a sort of generalization of what we did with the sorting order. But now I let you to the break. Okay?